Okay, I'm back. If there are more questions and comments, I will try to answer as good as I can.
Professor, regarding the sodium cluster,
Yes.
you show some figures where I can see some 111 planes.
Ah, okay. That is
Maybe
a
that's the reason about the this melting point. Maybe from the structure.
also I really think that the geometry, I'm not so sure how to say this because of course the electronic structure influences the geometry, right? So easy it is. The high temperature of the melting, I don't think it is a structural effect. What I believe it is an entropic effect because you have ja the delta S over T, that is delta Q, and that is a latent heat, and you have a lot of, I mean, you have a lot of equivalent positions on these icosahedral outside, because the cluster is ja not static. You see ja this dynamic inside the cluster, so you have a lot of occupation possibilities, and that gives you high entropy, and that makes you this high melting temperature. I think that is the best I can say. Because, look, if it would be a structural issue, only to conclude, then one would also expect some high stability, right? And that you don't see. You see the high melting temperature, but without a particular stability.
Okay,
Okay.
thank you for your
Ja,
answer.
okay. Maybe. Was es Alfredo? Alfredo, was you? Maybe was not so satisfying. But that is the best what I have in the moment. Okay. There's something else. How can we know what's the best functional to apply in one analysis? We don't. Also, the selection of the best functional, that is a question like the selection of the best basis set, right? Or there is not something like the best functional. What you can say, however, is the following. Also, if you look at optimized structure parameters, let's say bond length, you can really say that if you use LDA, the bond length usually is too short. And if you use GGA, the bond length usually is too large. So if you'd make these two optimizations, you make an LDA optimization and you make a GGA optimization, and your experimental bond length is not lying in between these two optimized structure parameters, but it lies far outside, then you know that something is going wrong fundamentally, either with your calculation or with the experiment to which you compare. That can ja also be that in the experiment they assume something that isn't true. That very often also happens. Okay? Good. So, fresh again after questions and everything. Then we are restarting our section, and let me pop up the presentation again. Ah, now I got it, that it stands here. So, do you see my presentation?
Yes.
Okay, so I would like to skip these here. To a large, no, I make it a little bit. Also, coming back because we had the question. Okay, I come back to the question now. Even so, it will not answer, I think, the question from Alfredo. It will not answer that, really. So one question is, why has the sodium 55 plus, we know now it is a quintet, such a large latent heat and a high melting temperature? We looked at this because the students finished basically the PhD, so the manpower was gone. We looked at this for smaller clusters, and we looked at the sodium 10. And when we looked at this, we looked at sodium 10 because that is the first cluster where you in the heat capacity curve can see such a kind of melting shape that you have here, the melting temperature here. This is a neutral cluster. No? This is why the melting temperature is so much higher. Not that you say, no, he made all this talking about sodium 55 plus and now comes here with such a high melting temperature, but this is neutral neutral cluster. If it would be a cation, it would not melt at all. It would be simply flat there. And you see it has a very, very small latent heat here. So we looked at this melting in particular because this is so small that we can really analyze this. And I can show you now here, these are the trajectories of these Born-Oppenheimer molecular dynamics for on the left-hand side at 250K before melting, right-hand side 400K after melting. Well, you might see some differences, but I mean, it doesn't really tell you very much that there's a melting transition in between, I find. No? So it's now not so that I can see, oh yeah, the right hand is the melted cluster. I mean, if I would not put the temperatures on it, I don't think you would guess what is melted and what is not melted. Maybe you would guess, but it's a little bit more moving on the right-hand side, that's true. Okay, so I think that this shows that structural pattern are not really so important for the melting. They are definitely important for the stability, but for the melting, maybe they are not so important. What we then did was we analyzed the molecular orbitals along these trajectories. And this here is for sodium 10 at 400K. What you see here is S, P, P, P. Now if you think about sodium 10, you have 10 electrons, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. So S, P, 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 D. And that is what you saw most on the trajectory. Very boring. 90% of the trajectory was this one. But then we saw for 10% a change in the ordering of these orbitals. And this change in the ordering of the orbitals, we only saw at 400K. So above the melting. Below the melting, this here was 100%. This was always S, P, 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 D, 100, 100, 100%. Only after melting, we saw such a change. And I show you this here. On the left-hand side, you see a trajectory cut before melting. On the right-hand side, you see a trajectory cut after melting. And what you see is here, the two highest occupied orbitals. Clearly, this is a P, clearly this is a D. If you look on this side here, however, you see something has happened. This here now is a D, and this has become a P. And then it flops back to PD. So what we see in these clusters is that the melting destroys the Aufbau principle of these cluster-type orbitals, as it was just shown here once again. Look the right-hand side, PD, 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 and now we make out of U, N, come on, DP, and there it goes back. Okay, so this is of course an insight you only can obtain if you have electronic structure along that. You can then show that in sodium 8, this is not there, but I don't want to go part. We believe that these orbital changes in sodium 55 plus are the reason for that. We don't have evidence for that because we don't have analyzed the trajectory really in detail so much, but that is something what we can say, and that is the conclusion. We believe that the sodium clusters are really special because they melt directly through the electronic structure. That is what we believe. That makes them really, really special clusters for this melting. It's not seen in aluminium and will also not be seen in copper also. Okay, so this was an application. Now let me go the last half hour or so on something that is again theory, and that is the inclusion of hybrid functionals. So Aldo talked yesterday a little bit about hybrid functionals in the sense, oh yeah, they are there and they might be of importance or might be not of importance. And in quantum chemistry, it's actually so that it seems that nothing else than hybrid functionals exist. I mean, everything what is calculated is done, at least in organic chemistry, and with hybrids. And obviously, there is a large problem, at least if you think about ADFT, because ADFT is based on top of an approximated density. And hybrid functionals are based on off-diagonal elements of the one particle density. So how can we incorporate hybrid functionals into a framework of auxiliary density functional theory without, I mean, falling back to the scaling of quantum chemistry? And I'm showing you briefly here overview about that. Also, we start with a Fock energy. This is a Fock energy. These are the off-diagonal elements. Here is R1 and R2 named of the one particle density matrix. So this is a Fock energy. This is the energy expression we need for hybrid functionals. This is the definition of these off-diagonal density matrix elements. We can now introduce a new quantity. We call it mixed orbital densities in this form. And then the Fock energy can be rewritten. This is exactly the same energy expression. It's only rewritten. You see, actually it looks more complicated because we have a sum here. But this energy expression, this is rho ij and rho ij tilde, is actually extremely good suited to do a variational fitting very similar to what we have done with the Coulomb potential, now, however, with the Fock energy. You see, these formulas look almost identical to what we have seen 2 hours ago. The only difference is that you have here the sum of ij. And the good thing is that each term you have in this sum, each term of this sum is, in this case, negative definite. So you can do exactly the same as we did with the Fock, with the Coulomb energy. You can do the same with the Fock energy. You can define an approximated Fock energy. Now this approximated Fock energy will be always larger than the true Fock energy, but because this is negative, it will be always less negative. That is what it really means. And I only remind you, we had a similar but opposite relation for the Coulomb energy. So if you use variational fitting of the Coulomb energy and of the Fock energy, we basically have two trends that are acting against each other. That means that we can expect error compensation. How large it is, we don't know, but we can expect error compensation because this black energy is the exact, in this case, Hartree-Fock energy. This here down is the Hartree-Fock energy approximated with the Coulomb fitting. And this here is the Hartree-Fock energy with approximated Fock fitting energy. If we put these two approximations together, we will get a result that is closer to the original Hartree-Fock energy than one of these two. That means if you do variational fitting and if you have Fock exchange inside your energy expression, you always will get better results, more close to your reference, when you make the fitting in the Coulomb part and in the Fock part simultaneously. Okay, then Daniel made the real calculation. These here are the total energy errors, not relative, total energy errors using this calculation compared to the reference, which is the black one. And these here, down here, these pink bars are the total energy errors. You see that the total energy errors are below 1 kilocalorie per mole. It is much better than anything else what is existing in the literature. It is when this, it still is, not only when it was published, but now it is used in several other codes. But when it was published, it was by far the most accurate approximation of Hartree-Fock without explicitly calculating for center integrals. And this is because we are simultaneously fitting Coulomb and Fock with the same auxiliary function set. And I show you now in a small movie here. What you see here is on the left-hand side, this is a four-center quantum chemical program. It is actually games, but it is not that it is not a good program. It is actually a very good program. It is our using four-center electron repulsion integrals. And this here is Demon 2K using this variational fitting of the Coulomb and Fock potential. So here are no four-center electron repulsion integrals involved. Three-center versus four-center. And you see the difference. The speed-up is roughly a factor of 10. And as you soon the system becomes larger, this is a small alkane chain, the speed-up becomes larger. That is really the impact this year had on quantum chemistry. And that is the reason why half a year later, this methodology was implemented in MolPro. It is implemented in QChem. A year ago, it was implemented in TurboMol. So it is implemented, except as in Gaussian, everywhere, one has to say. And we are quite proud of that, one also has to say. So I would not like to continue to go here in detail, because this is how this variational fitting of the Fock exchange is technically realized. I would skip this because of the time period. I would like to show this more pictorial. The key to the performance success of this implementation lies really in the MO localization. And what I show you here is a standard so-called canonical molecular orbital as you obtain it from the calculation of an alkane chain. And you see that this molecular orbital is delocalized over the full system you are calculating. And this is standard, independent if the system has delocalization units in terms of Pi systems also. This is a non-delocalized system. It's actually the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, which gives you that. Now, what you can do is, without changing the energy of the system, you can localize this orbital so that this molecular orbital is only centered on a few atoms. And when you do this, you now can use these localized molecular orbitals in the variational fitting of the Fock exchange, and then you can define auxiliary functions for this fitting that are only in this region. So auxiliary functions that are sitting here do not contribute to the fitting. They have nothing to do with this. So then my fitting is only done in a subset of the auxiliary functions used for the full system. And the same I can also do for the basis functions. In fact, the region for the basis function is larger than the region for the auxiliary functions because the fit is variational in the auxiliary functions, but it is not variational in the basis functions. So the basis functions are extended by a kind of additional cutoff radius. So for example, this atom would not carry auxiliary functions for our local Fock potential fitting, but it would carry basis functions for our local Fock potential fittings because the basis set here overlaps significantly with the basis set here. That is basically what this threshold is telling you. So this here are results from performance analysis, which are from Antonio. Basically what you see here, it is not only that the serial performance, which you have seen in the comparison of games and Daemon 2K is, so much improving, but it is also so that the parallel scaling with the latest implementation shows, decent scaling. It by far does not have the scaling of the of a GGA functional in terms of parallelization, but it parallelizes. And in fact, if you go to calculations, hybrid functional calculations at, let's say, with 12 cores or 24 cores, then these hybrid functional calculations are in Daemon 2K faster than meta-GGA calculations. Also, for example, if you use scan as a typical meta-GGA. So that makes it possible to have hybrid calculations now on larger systems with, also what you see here, yeah, is a few hundred of atoms. That is absolutely possible. Of course, the calculations are slower than LDA and GGA calculations, particularly when you go to seriously parallelized applications. Nevertheless, the hybrid functional performance analysis I'm giving you here is a comparison between four center hybrid functionals, so as they are implemented, for example, in Gaussian, and the three center implementation you have here. What you see is that the energy differences in these hybrid functional calculations, this here is for B through loop, using these 6311 G star basis set, you see that here the differences in the energy, this is 1 kilocalorie per mole. So the differences in the energy are in the range of 0.1, 0.2 kilocalorie per mole. That means that the hybrid functionals, as they perform in Daemon 2K, this is three center electron repulsion integral, give you de facto the same result as the ones in Gaussian with the four center electron repulsion integrals, only that the calculation is considerably faster. That is the difference. One can then come to the point where one really says, we had this question, how do I select the function? And I make here a point on Z. This here was a selection for a functional for C106 fullerenes. And we investigated this very much in detail here on these fullerenes, because what we wanted to know is what is the difference between a hybrid functional like PBE0 and a hybrid functional B3LOOP. From a theoretical point of view, these two hybrid functionals are in fact very different, because the correlation part they are using here is a correlation part that is based from the homogeneous electron gas, at least ultimately, whereas here in B3LOOP, the Li Yang par is based on helium 2 particle density analysis from Kohler and Salvetti, so completely different part from where this comes. We also, what we have here, these double slash means that we are doing geometry optimization at this level of theory. So this is PBE DZVP. That is a GGA level of theory that is applicable easily to systems with hundreds of atoms. You could even think about 1,000 to 2,000 atoms is possible on current architectures without any problem. And then what we do here, we do the geometry optimization on this level, and then we're doing only a single point energy calculation at with the hybrid functional, because it costs considerably more on computational demand. But you see here, we are using the same basis set. This is a rather small basis set for a hybrid functional. So here's the same. Here, however, we change basis sets when we go from the geometry optimization to the single point energy calculation here also. And these here are geometry optimizations and single point energy calculations here, doesn't make a difference, where we really use the hybrid functionals with these kind of large basis sets. These calculations are impossible with standard quantum chemical programs like Gaussian or games or so. They are only possible in the moment with our implementation. And what you see here is that we have here the references. Yeah. So we have done these reference calculations for these three structures. In reality, we have then later on calculated hundreds of these structures. But for these three structures, we went to do this. And now we can compare how are these relative energy differences reproduced with computationally less expansive methodologies. And what you see here is this reproduction is quite okay. We have errors in the range of 0.3, 0.4 kilocalories per mole. So we can say that we have semi-quantitative agreement between this very expensive calculation and these calculations that can be done on much larger systems and with much more systems. If you look in B3LOOP, the differences are not so much different, actually. So you can say the same, but the energy spacing in B3LOOP is unfortunately so small that you get qualitative different results at different levels. And in fact, it is so that also here, the B3LOOP and the PBE0 result and the highest level we have do not match with each other. So what this tells us is that the PBE0 energy separation is, in general, we can do this also for other systems, larger than in B3LOOP, and that also these hybrid functionals have at the end a resolution that is not better than a kilocalorie per mole also. So we are at the end for these applications when for the with PBE0 calculations and these composite approach, PBE0 optimizations, PBE0 single energy calculations, because we screened several hundreds of such structures. No? Here's another example where we look at activation energies and reaction energies. Yesterday, there was a question, can we do chemical reactions? Yes, you can do whatever kind of chemical reactions you want to do. It depends, of course, also a little bit how much work you put into this. But at the end of the day, you obtain such kind of energy profiles. This is just fine. Only here to show you, again, these are Biesrylep hybrid calculations. Here, these are the activation energies calculated with ADFT, so without four center Aries. Here, the reaction energies calculated with ADFT without four center Aries. Here, the same Gaussian, these are Gaussian results with four center Aries. If you look at the statistics, if you compare this value with this value, this value with this value, also here the absolute deviations, if you look at the statistics, what you find is there is no difference. There's no difference between four center Aries calculations and three center Aries calculations. So bottom line is, there is no reason for doing expensive calculations if you can do it much more cheaper and in the much less time and to the same accuracy. There's some issues, but these are not issues with the methodologies. These are also with four center versus three center Aries. These are issues with the underlying functional. And this I would like to point out here. Here you see something where for these reactions, you just saw the activation and reaction energy errors are plot against the functional. So here are the errors for PBE, and here for PBE zero, and so on and so on and so on. And the different colors refer to different basis sets. And the basis set quality improves from this blue color to this brown color, also from top to bottom here or from left to right here. And what you see is that in many cases, with the improving of the basis set, you see an improving of your quality of calculation. Then that shows that your functional and your computational methodology is doing something at least systematically. Of course, this can be systematically wrong, as this peak here shows you, but it is at least systematically. You see also something which is very disturbing, and that has to do with the Biesrylep functional. So in the Biesrylep case, if you make the basis set better, you actually get worse results. And the reason for that is that Biesrylep, when it was implemented, was optimized for this basis set. And you see that Biesrylep with this basis set actually performs excellent. But that doesn't mean that Biesrylep as a functional performs excellent. Performs excellent with this basis set. If you use a higher quality basis set, the performance of the functional becomes considerably worse. It's a factor of two. And if you summarize this up here, you see that this HSE06 functional for this part here performs probably best systematically and in absolute. And PBE0 also does quite well. We know about HSE06 has some pathologies. PBE0 does not have. So a message out of this slide is, if you do Biesrylep calculation, maybe you should switch to PBE0 and look a little bit of your basis set convergence performance. The DFT optimized basis sets are also beneficial for hybrids. That is, these basis sets, the orange one, that usually performs better than the blue one. This blue and orange have the same quality, except of course for Biesrylep, because Biesrylep has been optimized for the blue basis set, not for the orange one. Yeah, transition metal and hybrids. That is a long story, and the short answer is doesn't work. The not so short answer is it depends a little bit how your transition metals are inside your molecule. If you have one transition metal atom inside one compound, like we have this here in this chromium organometallic compound, then in fact it can be seen that PbE0 for here structure optimization does a damn good job if you compare to experiment and assuming that these experiments are crystal structure experiments. So there is definitely packing effect into these numbers. Then also with coupled cluster, singles, doubles, parentheses, triples, you will not come closer to these results here. And so you have de facto quantitative results with PbE0, using, of course, a considerably large basis set. So this is quintuple zeta. So it is a demanding calculation then also, and a large auxiliary function set. Here is something which I said in one answer for the accuracy, which functional we should use. Look at the red dots. So this here is the chrome C6A bond length. That is a bond length from here to here. So it's a transition metal carbon bond length. And this is experiment versus calculated bond length. Red is LDA. VWN is LDA. And you see that our calculated bond lengths are always smaller than the experimental ones. This is why all the red points are above the line. Then PbE is a GGA. Yeah, so this is the green data point, and you see that our calculated bond lengths are always larger than the experimental ones. So these are the bracketing of the experimental bond lengths, and then here you see the PbE0 bond lengths, and it's really also impressive. That is high ab initio level. What you can get here, and you see also this is true for other bond lengths, the same qualitative picture. If you look at the pictures, then where you have here a superposition of experimental and calculated bond structures, you see deviation mostly in this outer part, no, down here, maybe in this rotator, and here in these parts. And these are the groups that are most flexible, and they are then, of course, most vulnerable to crystal packing effects. This is a systematic study on other transition metals. As I come directly to the result. The result is that if you use hybrid functionals, you will always have an overstabilization of high spin states. So if you have spin competition between low spin and high spin, then the hybrid functionals will overstabilize artificially the high spin state. And that is a big problem for transition metal calculation. And that is why hybrids, when it really comes to transition metal clusters, honestly speaking, they are a fiasco. They should not be used there. This is performance, but I think. Okay, let me come to the end. ADFT and DMON2K, when to use? For computational demanding applications, so BOMD large molecules, or when targeting special molecular properties like dynamic polarizabilities and things like that, but this is something more we discuss on Thursday. Auxiliary function sets, I would suggest nowadays use always Gen2-STAR. With Gen2-STAR, you are always on the safety side. Of course, this is more expensive than using Gen2. What to avoid? This is very important. Never mix ADFT, because in DMON2K you have both. You have ADFT and you have Cohn-Sharm DFT. Never mix ADFT calculations with Cohn-Sharm calculations. So either you make ADFT calculations or you make Cohn-Sharm calculations. Don't mix them. That is not good. Here are some conclusions. I think most of this I have already said. I don't mind to give you the slides. So there is here also the recording, so you can look at this again. And this is perspective, things we want to do. Our next really big part is diagonalization-free density fitting and diagonalization-free SCF. Diagonalization-free density fitting has been done. It is implemented. It is what I have shown you for the COVID-19 polymerase used there. I think we can go to 500 auxiliary functions with this approach. Diagonalization-free parallel SCF is in the moment under development. We are, as usual, searching highly motivated PhD and postdocs, I have to say this, for such kind of work. If you know somebody or you are by yourself interested, please, please contact us. This is a big job, but it has also big reward. We will be able at the end to do calculations on systems with 10,000 atoms or even more. And something also what was mentioned, relativistic. We are interested in a two-component spinor SCF implementation. So that's quasi relativistic SCF with spin orbit coupling. Here for that, I really would search a physicist. And these are the open possibilities, but let me stay here and let me close this now. Coming back to my camera, here I am, and okay, that was it. I'm done. 5 minutes before time. Yeah, great. That was hard tobacco.
Professor, you want more questions or not?
Of course, I have questions forever. If you have. If you come with questions, I'm more than delighted. I'm happy to answer. Also in Spanish, please. Okay. Okay, here's a question. That is a good one. Saul, we could make a simulation of ADS. Sorry? Say it again.
There is one question.
Yeah, I had here. We could make a simulation of ADFT just to get a fast simulation and then make a simulation in DFT to get better results. Yeah. Okay, also, in principle, yes. In practice, as I have shown you, the ADFT results and the DFT results are the same. They differ by a tenth of a kilocalorie per mole. I don't know what this is in electron volts, but it is a fraction of milli electron volts. So there is no need, once you have done the ADFT calculations, to do the DFT calculation. They are not different at all. They give you the same result. That is what is the promise of density functional theory. If you could find the right functionals for the kinetic energy functional, and for the exchange correlation functional, you can calculate DFT calculations with the Thomas-Fermi analog, and it would give you exactly the same result as the perfect Cohn-Sham calculation. All of these DFT methods, Cohn-Sham, ADFT, Thomas-Fermi analog, are ab initio. They are first principle methods. Okay. Okay, feedback from Saul. Thank you. Other questions, other comments?
I think that the more important characteristic of your code is that you can make calculations with 100,000 of atoms, right?
100,000, I would be careful. Also, we can make calculations with a few thousand of atoms, but you need for that good computational resources. So what I shown you, the last calculation were 5,000 of atoms, and we are developing now on an implementation, that probably can do 10,000 of atoms. All of these atoms are quantum mechanically. What we then can do on top of that, we can embed this quantum mechanical part into molecular mechanics. And then we can come to system sizes of, let's say, 50,000, if you're very ambitious, 100,000 atoms. It could be possible to develop an alternative Popel spaces set with this auxiliary DFT. This is from Carlos. Carlos, correct. Absolutely correct. It has been done already. There is a basis set. It's called DZVP, double zeta valence polarization. It's a DFT optimized basis set, and it is exactly the same size as the Popel basis set. So these basis sets are available and they are used, and they perform considerably better if you use GGAs as the Popel basis sets, because John's basis sets were optimized for Hartree-Fock. And they also improve performance from hybrid functionals like PBE0 or HSE06. The exception is B3LIP, because that has been optimized for 631G star. The functional was optimized for the basis set, not the basis set for the functional. That was a different approach. Okay. More questions? Perfect, thank you. Okay, good feedback. Okay, guys, yeah, this with the questions, I'm not so happy. I must say, also your participation to this kind of summer school is absolutely mandatory. This here is not cinema with popcorn and Coca-Cola or Pepsi, if you like. But this is a scientific discussion forum. So you must ask questions. Otherwise, I am not satisfied.
Sorry, yeah. Marcelo has one question.
Yeah, adelante.
Okay, thanks again. One question. What about solvent models?
Yeah, solvent models.
Are compatible with this
yes,
auxiliary
yes.
DFT?
Yes, yes, yes. Solvent models come on Friday. We have a very primitive PCM inside Daemon 2K, actually not in the version I have here available, but in the version that is, there are several Daemon 2K versions around the world because it's developed in many, many groups. There's a Daemon 2K version with PCM, I think, in Montpellier and also in Toulouse. But what we are really doing is we are trying to develop an solvation model on the basis of QMM. I will discuss this in detail on Friday, because there's a lot of new thinking inside this model. And we are hot for solvation. That is true. We are very, really hot to make some solvation part. Absolutely, it's possible. I mean, I will show you examples where we can do this. Okay,
thanks.
You're welcome. Here's another question. I'm working on Gaussian or with Gaussian with fullerenes, but they are small, quite small, 28 atoms, but may result take between 1 day or 3 days. But ADF can work with more bigger clusters. How many time takes it to get results with the 110 fullerene? The 110 means a fullerene, I think, with 110 atoms. If you want to optimize and you have, let's say, 16 to 32 cores, optimization with 110 carbon atoms, I think 2 hours or less. The PBE0 calculation on top for the single point calculation, that might take 4 or 5 hours. But the optimization along 2 hours. That is, one of our students has scanned fullerenes. I think she went until 100, I don't remember. As a paper. If you are interested, drop me an email. I can send you the part. But she has optimized something like 10,000 structures of fullerenes with over 100 atoms. And that was something she did in, let's say, 2 months or 3 months when the machinery was fully working. She was first, of course, spending a lot of time to get the machinery working. But once it was working, the calculation went rather fast. Okay, more questions. Where can I find your email? Oh, my email. I can answer to all of you. My email is rcosta@synvestuff.mx. Okay, you get it? Everybody who has an I'm not on ResearchGate or any other commercial or non-commercial data distribution platform. We are Daemon2k is completely open source without any financial parts inside. We are completely academic, and we are not collecting data, nor do we distribute data. Okay. Good. I think lunch is coming and people are hungry. Okay, hi. What is the next step for the sodium cluster research? The next step is to find a really highly motivated PhD student for sodium cluster research. I think the next step would be to look at the sodium 55 plus versus the sodium 59 plus to answer these questions that have been also raised here. What is the difference between melting and stability? And the other part is to leave sodium, to go to copper, and even more interesting, to go to aluminium. I have funding from Argonne to run there these kind of molecular dynamics, Born-Oppenheimer molecular dynamics simulation in massive parallel architectures, which are, we are talking about 10,000 cores. And we do have a BOMD implementation now that can really use these cores. So as soon as somebody is really interested to do this work, please contact me. That would be something. I'm really searching a student for it. This is why I'm here, right? Let's say it's not only that I'm here to talk to you about
That question brings me.
Yeah, go ahead. There was a question.
Your calculation include all the electrons, right?
Yes. All the calculations you have seen are all electron calculations without pseudopotential. In fact, in our approach, the use of pseudopotentials is much less advantageous as in plane wave calculations, because in plane wave calculations, pseudopotentials are used to avoid plane waves for the core, because you need to build these cusps for the cores, and you would need, astronomic numbers of plane waves. In our case, because we have atom-centered basis sets, the representation of the core is not really so costly. We use mainly ECPs, as effective core potentials, and model core potentials to include scalar relativistic effects. That is our main issue. Okay, here's another question. Is there a correlation between the presence of some symmetry and computation time? Absolute. In fact, there is a large relation between symmetry and computation time. If you can use symmetry in your calculations, you can not only reduce the computational time, but you can also use the amount, you can reduce the storage request you need for your calculation. So you immediately, if you can explore symmetry, you can go to larger systems in less time. So yeah, to explore symmetry is a very good idea. If it is there and if it stays, is another question. If you think about the molecular dynamics, then it's not really so attractive to make molecular dynamics in some symmetries, right? So that is always the point. But yes, if it is there and if it is well part, then it's okay. Use it whenever you can. Okay, amorphous. Here we have something amorphous. Well, Ernesto, can you There it is. So the difference that I'm referring to is in computation time. This goes back to okay, I see. This goes back to symmetry. Sorry, I read this amorphous. Yeah, as I said, absolutely. Also, if you can explore symmetry and it fits to your scientific question, do it. It will save you time and also resources. Okay. Does it has the same in quasi crystals? Last one, sorry. Oh, Ernesto, that's a good one. No, it actually doesn't have. At least not the symmetry we are exploring in the moment, because the symmetry we are exploring in the moment is not quasi crystal symmetry. I think it could be possible to explore quasi crystal symmetry, but that would have to be done in a different sense as in the moment, because if you look at the crystalline system, in the moment the symmetry is everywhere. So if you have symmetry in the unit cell, then by the translation you have it everywhere. However, if you do, instead of putting the periodicity into your Hamiltonian, you put the periodicity in your interaction matrix, so to speak, in your interactions, then it might be possible to explore symmetry also for quasi-crystals. I will look at this a little bit on Friday, but not in the context of periodic systems and not in the context of quasi-crystals. Okay. 1:10. So you're welcome. At the demon meetings, usually at this time, the lunch bell is ringing and the people are leaving the room. And so I would suggest that we are finishing here. I gave you my email. Any question, anything, thank you for that. Anything you need, anything you want, please drop me an email. And remember, in the afternoon session, also ask Gerald, ask Antonio. They are the people who really can help you. Thank you very much that you were staying with me. That was not an easy talk, but I'm happy for the questions, and I hope this will become even more on Thursday and Friday. Okay, bye-bye.